eternal and everlasting God, tonight is a great night. Lord, I pray that that our souls will be blessed. Lord, this sermon is important. But there are so many families are in problems. But you have designed this sermon to help them. May the Holy Ghost move up and down within these chairs. First, God, move on me, that my tongue will be loosened, my mind will be illuminated. And God, may the people hear the truth and accept in Jesus' name. Amen. Let me be seated. Yeah. Love. Come on, help me now. Courtship. Uh-huh. And marriage. Uh-huh. Yes, and marriage. Oh, yes. Ladies and gentlemen. Yes, I was trying to... the definition for love. Uh-huh. And I see that the definition is to show great affection for something or someone, especially of the opposite sex. I say the opposite sex. Yes, yes. I am making no bones about it. Opposite sex. I'm not talking about same sex, that kind of love. Now, do you know that there are different types and different degrees of love?
Yes.
For instance, someone says, well, I love my house. You hear me now? I love my house. Another one says, I love this piece of land. You hear people now say, I love my dog. And a woman will say, I love my husband. And a man will say, I love my wife. And then you'll hear Christians say, I love God. Well, let me say to you, right off the bat, that all these loves are not the same.
True.
Come on, listen to me now. You see, the English language is at times very limited, so that it uses one word to express very many meanings. But it is not so in the Greek and Hebrew. Let me give you a reference. In the Greek, there is a type of love that is called eros. E-R-R-O-S. Uh-huh. Now, I'm going to explain them for you a little later. Now, another one is called philia. Yes. Yes. And there is another love, another one in the Greek, that is called stoge. Yes. S-T-O-G-E. Stoge. And then there is another one that is called agape. Uh-huh. Right. Yes. Now, agape. Now, do you know that all these are translated into English, love? Now, which one do you mean? No. Okay, eros is sexual love. Y'all didn't hear me. I say sexual love. Uh-uh. It is from the word eros that you get erotic. Nobody's listening to me. Now, I'm coming to that now. Now, philia, we all know it is brotherly love. It is from philia that we get the word Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love. Now, when I speak of loving Brother Stuart, my brother here in the faith, that is filial. Okay.
Yes.
You get it? Now, there is another one called stoge, that is family affection, that is your immediate family now. Not just brothers in the church, but your immediate family, your blood brother or your blood sister, your siblings. Come on, you're not listening to me. And then there is the last one here is agape. Now, agape love is the highest form of love.
True.
This is the one that is governed by principle.
Yeah.
When God says, when the Bible says that God loves the sinners, the love that God has for sinners, it is agape love.
Yes.
Because even while we were yet enemies, Christ died for us.
Yes.
This kind of love is not ordinary love. This is love that is governed by principle.
Yeah.
All right, now. Now, the question I have to ask you all, and you all can answer, you know, which of these loves, husbands and wives, ought to have for each other? Agape, huh? Agape, huh? No, you are not thinking, you know. You are not thinking. So now, I imagine that those of you who want pure agape love, that you don't want these here, especially you don't want this one. Now, somebody here said it's all. But I want to tell you something now. You may feel a little too holy tonight to say it. But marriage, there is a whole lot of sex in marriage. And if you don't have that that eros, you're in trouble.
True.
No, y'all don't hear what I'm saying. It's a whole lot. Listen, my friends. If you're married for 40 years and 43 years, you know how much you...
Bring it on.
Rita, what do you say?
Right with you there, man.
Now, I'm serious now. Now, listen, my friends. When a girl and a boy meet, and immediately they fall in love, they call it love at first sight. Now, most of this man, in 99.99% of the time, it is erotic love.
Yes.
Because you don't know anything about each other. Now, what happened there is that this girl looks at the fellow. He has wonderful physique. Come on, muscles are tearing through his shirt. Come on, he's handsome, perfect physique. And when he looks at her, she is symmetrically built.
Oh, yes.
36, 24, 36. Well-shaped calves and ankles. And already he begins to interpret the unknown or the unseen. Nobody's listening to me tonight. Now, strange enough, reader, that many men begin to examine a woman from up, down, come up. To see the shape of her legs. And
yes.
I'm talking sense here.
Yes.
Come on, nobody's listening to me.
Yes.
Yes, I said some men examine ladies up. Come on. I know what I'm talking about. Now, what it means to fall in love. We're going to talk about falling in love now. You know, I'm speaking to the young folks who are not yet falling in love. Now, the attraction between a boy and a girl that leads them to falling in love is natural gift from God.
Yes.
Y'all didn't hear me?
Yes.
No, I said it's natural. Oh, no. Nobody's, y'all not saying a word.
Yes.
It's a God gift.
Yes.
So that. Now, I don't have any daughters. I have a foster daughter. And I tell you something. I guided her through life. I tell you all a little about her. Now, if I have a 16-year-old girl at home, and no boy is calling her on the phone. Now, I am not saying that she's supposed to be seriously in love, but at least she's supposed to look good enough for somebody to see her and take her phone number.
All right. I hear you.
Because it is natural. I say it is natural Now, I am this man. I will guide her that she ought not to fall seriously in love yet. But at least I want somebody to be calling my daughter. Yes, man. I want somebody to call my daughter. And later on, I want somebody to come home for me to give them a little trouble.
Yes.
Oh, yes, man. I would have enjoyed that. I know in my heart I'm going to say yes, but I'm going to give him some trouble. Now, ladies and gentlemen, in order for people to fall in love, they must meet.
Yes.
I say they have to meet.
Yes.
All right, now, where do people meet? It's amazing where some people meet and when they meet and why they meet. Now, there are some people who meet in church. Nobody hears me.
Yes.
And truly, one of the best places in church to meet is on the choir. Y'all didn't hear me. I say, you meet. You hear that beautiful voice there, and you follow the voice. Now, you meet in church. That's the place you can meet. And that is why I'm saying to you, ladies and gentlemen, that if your church is small, for heaven's sake, visit. Listen, during World War II, when General MacArthur landed on the Philippines, he was right up on the forefront. And some of his under generals were saying, but General, why are you so close up to the front? And you should be back in fine. He said, if you don't see them, you can't shoot them. What I'm saying now, if at all you are not seen, nobody is going to shoot you. In order for you to get shut down, young lady, somebody has to see you.
Yes.
So you don't hide yourself in a tiny little church here. Go and visit.
Amen.
Am I making sense here? Yeah, you got to visit. Now, hold on. Another place that people meet, I'm telling you now, at camps. And that is why our church has youth camp every year, every summer. And while they may not tell you, they may tell you, come, you are going to get all kind of spiritual things. In the back of the mind, ladies and gentlemen, is for young people to meet. Listen, man, common sense tells you that people have to marry. And if you're going to marry, you got to meet. All right, now, so you got to meet. Now, another place that is good to meet is at the supermarket.
You sure?
Oh, yes, a whole lot of people got at the supermarket. Or at the mall, too. Yeah. Oh, yes. Yeah. Yesterday, I went to Chin City Mall, and a whole lot of people, you see there, people walking on the place. Man. Yes. Man. You're going to meet. Now, another place you meet is on college campuses. You see, you go to college for 4 years. And within that four years, it's four sets of ladies and four sets of men that pass through there. And somewhere along the way, you will see somebody. You should find somebody to fit your profile of compatibility. Now, another place to meet, and one of the best places to meet now, the best, is right here at the tent.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
No, I'm serious. Listen, my friends. Listen. I'm saying the tent is one of the best places to meet. Now, and especially for some ladies who feel that they are over the hill, somebody going to see you at the tent. I never forget there in 1979. Now, I'm telling you all a story. I'm telling you a story and you're laughing at me. I said, 1979, I had a tent meeting in Antigua, right there on Michael's Mount. And these two people, you would have thought that they were over the hill. The lady was over the hill. She was in her, when you're in your early 30s, when you're 33 years old, you're counted as well on the shelf. But ladies and gentlemen, I'm telling you the truth. One of my friends was also in his early 30s. He was unmarried. And I saw them. Now, I was up there preaching. I'm there preaching, and I see them at the back of the tent talking. I knew something was going on. Listen, folks, you have to have an eye for these things. The moment I saw them there talking, and now, if they talk for one night, that's not bad, not bad enough. But when you see them come and find each other every night of the crusade to talk.
Yes, yes, yes. Mm-hmm.
Listen, my friends. They met at the crusade in, the crusade began on the 27th of May, 1979. And by the 26th of August, 1980, the next year, they were married.
Yes.
Yes. And they're still married.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. Yes. If you go to Antigua, ask for Verlin Miller and Rudolph Miller. Yes, they go to the Villa Church. And listen, my friends. One time I was in Antigua, and there were the carpenter that built the stage was not married, and a young lady was there, and somehow I just took the young lady. She was not married. He was not married. So I took them together, and I put their hands together. I said, "Hey, fella, marry the girl." Listen, my friends. When I went back there 7 years later, I didn't know the guy took my advice. I did not know he took my advice. But when I got back there, they had a big child. The girl was singing for me, and I said, "Pastor, is that day when you put my hands on his?" It started. And right here, 20 years ago, I told a young lady, "Marry the guy." I ain't telling you all who it is. And they married. I said to them, "Marry the girl, marry the fellow." Because she was cutting style. Hey, you know, Milton, I like this light. It's good like Milton. I ain't telling you all who it is. Now, sometimes, I say sometimes, you might even meet on the street. Now, it was 1972, conference session in Barbados. A friend of mine came from Montserrat to represent one of the churches in Montserrat, and this young lady came from St. Kitts. And they were walking on the streets close to where the conference session was held. And as they passed, he looked back at her, and she looked back. Well, you know, any time a young lady looks back at you, you have her. Uh-huh. They got married the next year. Yeah, that's how they met. Yes. Now,
looking back.
Just like that. Now, there's some folks who marry their next door neighbor. Now, I give you for instance, now, in Hollywood, people don't stay married long.
True.
But there was one marriage, there were one of the few marriages that lasted for almost 60 years. And it was one of those stars by the name of Alice Faye. And the other one was Phil Harris. Now, Phil Harris and Alice Faye were next door neighbors. But they lived in such big houses that they did not know each other. One morning, both of them were walking their dogs. Yeah.
Walk the dog.
And they were walking the dog. And they crossed each other. And Alice Faye's dog beat up on Phil Harris's dog. And the result of that meeting, of that beating up, they got married, and they lasted for 60 years until Harris died. Man. He died at the age of 93.
Man.
And Alice Faye died at the age of 80-something sometime later. But it was the dogs that brought them together.
Walk the dog.
Now, some people meet their life partners while they are touring a foreign country. Now, in 1996, there was Switzerland got one gold medal, the first ever, and it was a gymnast. The guy was from China, but he was now a Swiss citizen. How it all happened? This young lady, a Swiss young lady, went to China on vacation, and she wanted to find some place. He met the young man on the street and asked direction. Ladies and gentlemen, he gave her direction, and they ended up falling in love and got married. And he left China and went to Switzerland and became a Swiss citizen. So he performed for Switzerland. So that's why Switzerland was able to get its first ever gold medal. They met. I say, some people even marry their classmates. Now that is true. Ah, yes. I ain't telling you all. But I finished my exam one day. And I was outside with the boys talking. You know, and a classmate of mine stepped off the platform and came down and said, "Lend me a pen," and she did it with a smile. And I remember it was a black pen called Gold Flake. And I lent her the pen. The rest is history. Trust me, that's how it started. The rest is history. Yes, ma'am. In Jesus' name. Now, God did not make anybody particularly for that person, except in the case of Adam and Eve.
True.
Eve was made for Adam.
Yeah.
So that, let me, don't ever think that you can find your mate only one place. Because some people have to travel. Come on, some people travel out of their country. Am I talking to you?
Yes.
So that, if you leave Guyana to come to Trinidad.
Yes.
God has somebody in Trinidad.
Amen.
To meet your profile of compatibility.
Oh, yes.
Come on, am I talking to you again?
Yes.
Now, am I talking to you here?
Yes.
Yes, so wherever you go. Now, that is why we have some young men who left Antigua, Nevis, St. Kitts, St. Croix, and came to Trinidad, and they have Trinidad wives.
True.
They came here to college. Am I talking sense here? Some of the folks here, right here now, have wives from other countries.
Yes.
Not you, Pastor Michael. Your wife is from Trinidad, eh?
Yes.
Right. Mm-hmm. But you know of Guyanese that came here?
Yes.
Yes. And get Trinidad wife?
Yes.
In Jesus' name. Oh yes. Now, ladies and gentlemen, hear me now. And I'm talking to those who are in love and those who are to fall in love. It is not good to rush into marriage so soon after falling in love. There should be a period of courtship. Nobody hears me. There got to be a period of courtship. Now, I'm not telling you how long courtship ought to be. But there are exceptions to the rule. Now, let me give you the exception first before I get down. I have a friend in St. Croix whose wife died in April. And I remember the last Sabbath in November, he came to church in dark glasses, dark shades, and said how he was crying for his wife. Now, I'm giving you a story that is true. He was crying for sister so-and-so. He missed his wife. The next Sabbath, which was the first Sabbath in December, when I came to church, he was there in the parking lot, and a sister was there talking to him, and he was looking serious and sad, and the sister was calling him over something. Not my business. I did not get involved. Now, I left the Sunday morning and went to Oakwood College for the Ministerial Evangelism Council. When I got there, I called my wife. Because you know we can call people now. Cell phone. Yes. So when I called her, she said, "But do you know what happened last night? Brother so-and-so was married." The same brother that was crying last Sabbath, married. Now, his wife died in April, and by December, he was married. The first Saturday night in December, he was married. Well, now, don't groan at him. The guy is in his 60s. What do you expect him to do? To court for 5 years? Now, when you reach up there in age, you don't have time to waste. Now, but the beauty about it, no, the good thing about it is, listen now, the guy loved the first wife. He loved the first wife. And the children were the ones who encouraged him to get married. Because the guy seemed as he was comfortless. But the wife that he married complimented the first wife. A wonderful lady she is. Trust me, she is a nice person. Yeah. So everybody loves the second wife too. And she's not worried that the brother loved the first wife, because she knows that the brother loves her too. Yeah. But it's good. He's a nice fellow. Very nice guy. I'm glad for him. And the children are happy now.
Amen.
Yeah, you see their children were all grown. And they wanted their daddy to be happy. So they want her. Now, let's move on now. Now, let us look at the progression. We are looking now at the progression, reader.
Yes.
From falling in love and marriage. From one to the next. How do you get there? Now, first of all, remember I said that you have to meet.
Yes.
You got to meet.
Yes, yes.
Now, some of you young men, even when you meet, you don't know what to say.
True.
Because you see the girl and you are impressed with the girl, and all you can say is, "Hey girl, I love you." And you lose the battle right there. You don't meet a girl and say, "I love you." Not one time like that. What happens? You have to learn to take off the plane. You have to take off the runway and fly the plane and land the plane without destroying the passengers.
Yes. I like it.
Now, I tell you now, when you meet the girl, the fella's not listening to me. Now, when young man, when you meet that young lady and you are impressed, look for something genuinely that you can compliment her for. If it is her hairdo, tell her, "Man, you have a beautiful hairdo." And go on. Or it may be the blouse that she's wearing. That blouse makes you look wonderful. And do you know that the next time she knows she's going to meet you, she's going to put on that same blouse? Now, you have to get her attention. Now, I'm saying, if you meet her at the supermarket, then try and help take down the thing from high up there for her. Now help her. You all didn't hear me? Now, having done that, always look for, now you're looking for the opening. You're looking for the opening. It's not love yet. You don't, even though you have, the love that you have is sexual love. You don't know nothing about the young lady. Now, the next step is, you have to find something common that both of you can discuss. Now, during the campaign, I said during the American campaign, it was quite easy for both of you to talk about Obama.
Yes, yes.
But that was a talking town. But you got to find something that the young lady is interested in, and you too, so you all can talk. You all didn't hear me?
Yes.
Now, that is meeting. You got to meet. Now, first, you got to be friends. Now, nobody hears. There has to be an attraction. Having met, there has to be an attraction. Now, after the attraction, there must be friendship developed. Now, any married couple will tell you that there are problems in marriage. And when everything else, when all the cohesion is loosened, the one that is going to keep you married is that friendship that you all developed long ago.
True, true. Say it, man. Say it.
You all didn't hear me? If you and your spouse have been friends, it is going to hold you. It is going to be like the cohesion that you're going to hold. It will not be loosened easily.
Amen.
Listen, my friends. I don't care how good the sex is. You all can have sex morning, noon, and night. Sex will never keep you all married.
Amen.
It is something else. Is that friendship? Yes. You all agree with me?
Yes.
So, young men, you got to be friends first. You can't go look sexy like that. Wait, you're married now? Don't rush it. Yes. Now, after the friendship, there is dating. Now, you're getting closer to being exclusive. You begin to date. Nobody's listening to me. All right, now. Now, then after that now, dating is not courtship yet.
True, true.
For you have not yet landed the question. Now, ladies and gentlemen, when you've had some dates and you all have maneuvered around certain topics, then now you can land the question. You can let the young lady know how you feel. That is what you call landing the plane.
Yes.
Come on, all right, listen to me now. Then now, after you tell her how you feel, and she accepts you, she tells you she feels the same way about you, you can begin the courtship. But you don't begin to quote the moment you meet. You meet today and you begin to quote.
Trouble.
That's crash landing. You're not listening to me, Hey, Chappie, you hear what I say? Old school. Now, during courtship, my friends, it is engagement. And after the engagement is the marriage. Now, the great question now to the young ladies, because here is where some of you have faltered. You all have gone way out of bounds. At which point should your parents, the parents of the girl, be involved? Well, I say it is before dating. Before dating. And I will tell you why. The young lady is, listen, young ladies, if you have problems in life with men, 99.9% of the time is because your parents are not involved. Trust me, you are going it alone. And men take advantage of young ladies that are alone.
True.
You see? Come here. I'm coming down to you. You see, courtship is getting to know each other close up before taking the final leap into marriage. So I will counsel you to be natural. I say what? Be natural. Now, don't over-impress. I'm going to give you a for instance. It is like this young lady who was in love with this young man. Now, every afternoon when he came home from work, he would go to the young lady's home. And he thought he was having a good time because the young lady would comb his hair, you know, and he will take off his shoes and put his feet up in her lap, and she would accept it. And she would caress, she would comb the hair and caress the feet. And so he thought, well, this was the young lady that was going to make me happy for the rest of my life. So he married to her. And after the marriage, he was doing the same thing, put the feet up in her lap. And I'm telling you the truth. But this is how some people are. After she got married, she didn't have the same desire for him again. She pushed the foot out of his lap, out of the lap. And instead of, while she used to be caressing and say nice word like footsie footsie, she was a real West Indian. So she didn't say gentleman. He said, nigger man. Nigger man, take your hoof off to my lap. So now, it was foot, footsie footsie, but now it is hoof.
Yes.
Yes. Now, I'm saying also that during courtship, I'm trying to say here that people ought to be natural. Now, if you have a bad temper, display it. Listen, my friends. Nobody is perfect. And I'm saying my future spouse should know what he or she has to live with. What usually breaks up a marriage is when that marriage is shocked. Come on. Let me use another language. When it received a chill. You know, like when you are in a hot room and you come out in the open and the open is cold, you get a chill. Well, it is like that. You have something that you are hiding up. You hold it back. And when you are married, then you explode. That is what gives... Now, let me give you a for instance. Now, this guy was a drunkard, but he kept it under... He never allowed the lady to know that he was a drunkard. Well, when he got married, he began to drink heavily. He brought home little money, or little or no money. And the lady suffered, but she was a very good lady. She loved him, and she continued to cook. And wherever she went, whenever she could, she would bake something nicely for him. But he was treating her badly, beating her at times. One night, he was coming home drunk. And they had a big sow hog. And he fell down beside the sow hog, the big pig. You know what that's called, a sow hog? You all know a sow hog, that's the female hog, it's the sow. The male is the boar. The castrated pig is the barrow. I told you all Tuesday night. So now, he fell down in beside the pig, in the pig pen. And he slept there. He slept there all night until the coming toward the morning when the liquor now was gone. And he turned and felt something beside him. And he put his hand around the pig, thinking that it was his wife. And when the hog grunted, he jumped up. Now he was sober. He jumped up and he looked and he said, "This is what liquor has brought me to." He never tasted another drop of rum. When he realized what rum had brought him down to be sleeping in a pig pen. Now, I'm moving on. Now, I'm saying here. I said courtship is getting to know each other up front before taking the final leap into marriage. You got to be natural. Don't overimpress. Now, I want to counsel the young ladies. Because young ladies are the ones who are very vulnerable. And what I mean is, a young lady is 19, she's looking very good. She's at her best. And some young man, at the age of 22, falls in love with her. And then he quotes her and quotes her and quotes her until, for 5 years later, 6 years later, she's now 25. And when the lady thought that she was going to be married to him, he drops her for a younger girl. Oh. At this time, she's still looking good, but not in the flower for years. Now, all that can be avoided when the lady doing two things. Number one, young ladies, always be hard to get. Okay. Now, that's what I want to tell you. Now, a young lady has to be hard to get. Now, a lady getting married has nothing to do with beauty. Because if you are beautiful and you are easy to get, hardly any man is going to marry you when you are easy to get. You see, a man loves a challenge.
Yes.
Always remember that. A man will have a fling and a play with any girl he can get easily, but when the time comes to be married, he's going to marry to somebody that was harder to get. You see, when you are hard to get, the man becomes curious and becomes more determined, and you get harder. Even when your heart is bursting out, give him some trouble. No, I'm serious. Give him some trouble. Now, secondly, young ladies, now I'm talking to you. Young ladies, always involve your parents.
Amen.
Now, my great-grandfather died on the 18th of September, 1953. I was 8 years old at the time. And it was five of us were living in the house. My grandmother, my great-grandfather, my sister, my younger sister, and a cousin, an older cousin. Right, Melvina. Now, shortly after my great-grandfather died, a certain gentleman came from the village in for Melvina. It was now only my grandmother. And I never forget that night when he came in. My grandmother asked him a question. What are your intention for Melvina? Listen now. And he said, I intend to make her my wife.
Amen.
Now, I listen to me. Now, that was late 1953. And they got married on the 29th of December, 1955. You say, Pastor, you remember? Man, you remember. That's easy to remember. But you see, what happened now? It was because my grandmother was involved. So Louis used to come in. And if Louis was going to spend year after year after year after year, then my grandmother was going to call him aside and ask him, hey, what happened? You see, what you can't ask the young man, daddy and mommy can ask.
True.
And mommy and daddy are there for protection. Listen, man, you can't go wrong when your parents are involved. Now, I am not saying that when he comes home there, the parents are supposed to sit in the same long chair there. Man, the parents should pull aside and let you all say what you have to say. Now, let me give you a fine sense. Now, when I was living in Montserrat, now, we had this young lady who came to live with us, you know? And I noticed that she was 18 years old, and when one of the young elders of the church was talking to her, I was having a crusade, and, you know, they were talking, and I liked the young fellow. So I was glad to know that they were talking, but I already gave her instruction that anybody who loves you, first, they got to come and ask permission first. So one Saturday night, I received the call. Pastor Daniels, I want to date Karen. Well, it's two mistakes the guy made. First, you call me Pastor Daniels. Well, you don't deal with that subject to me on the phone. No. On the phone? No, sir. That's a face-to-face conversation.
Yes.
Not on the phone. And secondly, Montreal is so small. We're gonna take Karen to court. So when people see you there in that corner, they're gonna say that's Pastor Daniel's daughter. No, that's gonna damage my ministry. All right, so I told him, listen, man, you gotta come to my home. So about a day or two, he came to the home. And he said it again. I would like to take Karen for a date. Well, I asked him, I remember what my grandmother asked, the question my grandmother asked. So I asked, what are your intentions with Karen? He said, Pastor, you're taking this thing too seriously. No, serious. He said I was taking it too seriously. Well, you see, I couldn't otherwise than take it seriously. Because when that girl makes a mistake, that mistake is going to live with her for the rest of her life.
True, true.
You go and spoil that girl. It's life, it's lifetime. Let me tell you something. Virginity does not return. I am going to protect her. And I'm going to tell you all what happened. I'm serious. That was the last moment that he ever talked to that girl. Because my wife and I demanded, that's not the one for you. Stop it. Stop it right away. Too serious? No, I'm serious. I am serious. So the next year, that was 1985. The next year we went to Anguilla for a crusade. And she was there with us. But I didn't even know that she was doing her thing around the tent. She was supposed to be an usher. Had an usher's uniform and all. And then the last week of the crusade, I was home. One Sunday when my wife called me and said, somebody's here to see you. It's a young man who came to see me, to see us. The young man wanted to quote Karen. So we told him, come back. No. Come back tomorrow night. It was Sunday. Come back tomorrow night. So he came back. And we put Karen out of the room. No, you're not supposed to hear. So my wife and I sat with him. We asked him, okay, what are your intentions? That's the first question. He said, I want to make Karen my wife, but I want permission from you to quote her, to talk to her. But that sounds good.
Amen.
Okay. All right. We didn't give him the okay. We told him, okay, come back tomorrow night for the answer. No, I'm serious. Come back tomorrow night for the answer. No, we got to do it step by step.
Amen.
So when he was gone, I don't know how Karen felt about him. So I had to find out how Karen felt. So when he was gone, now we called Karen to find out how do you feel about the young man? So Karen said, well, I love him. Well, if you love him, well, we can give the okay.
Yes.
So when he came back the other night, it was a short meeting. Okay.
Amen.
No, that's how it is. No, I believe in the right way.
Amen.
Protection. No, that was 1986. No, the girl went off to college. But in 1988, they got married. Yes. Right, listen to me now. Because we were there to protect. Yeah, we protected her as though she were our own daughter. We were not going to treat her any different than if she were our daughter. Yes.
Amen. Yes.
And so, you understand now, young ladies?
Uh-huh.
Now, when you have found out enough, I say, when you have found out enough about each other, it is time for the engagement. I say, it is time for the engagement.
Yes.
And engagement has no anniversary.
I hear you.
I say, engagement has no anniversary. You see, the engagement now is the period to prepare for the marriage.
Yeah.
Right. Now, do not finalize the date before you clear it with your pastor. Now, there are some people who have some bad mind. Real bad mind. They have bad attitude, I must say. That they set the date. And they mean even the pastor has to go to Jamaica, to the university, that he must break that engagement over there to come and marry me. No, you don't plan the date and then go and tell the pastor to fit in. No, sir. I wouldn't do it. Do it the right way. Before you finalize the date, make sure the pastor is available.
Amen.
Y'all didn't hear me. All right. Make sure the pastor is available. I'm coming down now. Now, it is very important that both sides of the family, of families, be involved in the relationship, since each will be marrying into the other's family. Hence, son-in-law, daughter-in-law. Now, get ready now, Brother Stuart. On the day of the wedding, get ready, Brother Stuart. Well, not yet. Just get ready. I said ready. You know when they say when they're in the Olympic they give a sign when you're supposed to get ready, and then the gun goes off to start. Well, the gun is not off yet, Brother Stuart. Get ready. Now, on the day of the wedding, the groom with his best man nervously sits right in front and waits. And worse yet, the bride is half hour late. That's not too bad. She's 3/4 of an hour late. Not bad either. But she's an hour and a half late. And while he waits, he sweats.
Yes.
The best man wipes his brow. Finally, the bride arrives on the arms of her father or stepfather. And Brother Stuart, now, the organ begins to play. Here comes the bride. Come, couple, stand. Wonderful. All right. Okay. All right. Pastor Michael Phillip, take over now.
As we said, we want you to look each other in the eyes.
Now, folks. Let there be no laughter yet. No, no laughter, please. No laughter. This is serious now. Some of these folks have been looking forward to this long time. And we are not going to disappoint them. It's a serious thing when folks are now about to renew their covenant. Pastor Michael, take over.
Gentlemen, I would like you to repeat after me. All gentlemen who are taking the vows. Tonight, gentlemen, repeat after me. Tonight, we stand at the point of a new beginning. While you are doing this, please look at your spouse.
Yes, straight in the eye.
And I want you to know that you are still the only one I want to be with. I want you to know that you are once, twice, three times a lady. You are my number one, and I love you. You stuck with me through rough times and smooth times, through the ups and the downs, when I was weak and when I was strong. You have been more to me than anyone else in the world. So tonight, I choose you again, and I promise to love you and cherish you in sickness and in health, for richer, for poorer, for better, for worse, till death do us part. And therefore, I pledge you my love again. Ladies, look at the gentleman in the eye.
All right, be quiet, my friends, be quiet, very quiet.
Tonight, ladies, tonight, we stand at the point of a new beginning, and you are still the only one I want to be with. I want you to know that you are the man of my dreams, and I love you. I knew you were mine the first time I saw you. You stuck with me through rough times and smooth times, through the ups and the downs, when I was weak and when I was strong. You have been more to me than anyone else in the world. So tonight, I choose you again, and I want you to know that I promise to love and to cherish you in sickness and in health, for richer, for poorer, for better, for worse, till death do us part. And therefore, I pledge you my love again. Because of the vows you have taken this evening in the presence of this congregation, I now pronounce you husband and wife again.
Hold on. Not yet. No. Wait. Now, folks, you got to do it all over again. Now, what I mean, when you were finished the first time, you gave each other a real kiss. So now, this is time for you all.
Again.
Hang on now. Again.
Again.
Again. Come on, again. Again. The real thing. The real thing. All right. Now, I have an announcement to make. Now, after marriage is the honeymoon. I say, after marriage is the honeymoon. Now, I want you all to take time for a second honeymoon. If you didn't have a first one, well, have one now. But I don't want you all to go until I tell you what to do. So, next week, I say next week Wednesday. Next week Wednesday night, I continue with the subject, thank God for sex.
Amen. Amen.
Now, next week again, I want all only married couples in here. The others will be on the other side. But married couples, I want to be directly talking to you. Next week, Wednesday night, thank God for sex. Now we're going to finish up. Now, lady, now that you are married, the question is, how do you keep your marriage sweet? I'm going to give you just a few quick tips. Number one, you have to continue the early affection. Now, keep your early affection. And number two, you have to keep up the personal appearance. You got to be always desirable. Men are attracted by sight and smell, while ladies are attracted by touch. And ladies love flowers. You all hear me? Now, as I said, you got to keep that early affection, because if you don't keep the affection, now if you used to give flowers, continue. Yes, whatever yes. You did before when you were courting, you continue. Now, I went to St. Croix canvassing one time, and I went by this lady, passed by her home, and she and her husband were not living together. But I noticed something, that the husband did not go and live with another woman. The husband went and lived with his sister. So I asked her, well, you know, when last you told your husband that you love him? She said, Brother Daniel, that's a thing of the past.
Uh-oh.
So I gave her some counsel here. Mind you, I was a student in COC. I told her, the next time your husband came home, to give him a big hug, pull him in the kitchen and give him a hug and a kiss, and tell him how much you love him. So 1 year later, I went back to the same house. When I got there, she was rocking a baby.
Amen.
And she said to me like this, Brother Daniel, this is the result of it. She and the husband were sweet again.
Yes.
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 Now, what I'm telling you here, I'm not giving you made up stories. These are facts. 1974, I met her, and 1975, she had a baby. All right, now, the next point I want to make here, you got to keep the we feeling. Now, too many husbands and wives don't trust each other. So that the husband works for his money, and he banks his own money, and so he pays for the current, and the wife works for her own money, and she pays for the water bill. I mean, listen, there is no cohesion in the marriage. They don't trust each other. Listen, man, there is something in marriage called trust.
Yes.
Folks, you got to trust each other. And when you are married, you become one.
Amen.
So that if the husband works for $100 and the wife works for $150, then the budget is built off of $250.
Yes.
Now, my wife and I, we are married for 43 years.
Amen.
And I mean, honest to goodness, I don't think my wife has any secret from me, and I don't have any from her. So that, don't write me a letter and say, don't let your wife read it. My wife can read it. I don't want a letter from anybody that my wife can't read. I want no secret like that. We have no secret bank account. Everything Amen. We have together. So that I don't have to make a will, say, for my wife. Because if I die suddenly, my wife, she owns everything already. Mm-hmm. Now that is how it is supposed to be.
Yes.
We hide nothing. Listen, my wife, even in what you call her, you know, now we have the general money, but my wife feels that she needs, a monthly allowance. So the monthly allowance is put there on a checking account. And her name is on it, but mine is on it too. And I'm telling the truth, my wife doesn't need any money. She doesn't need it. She only put it there to give away. Yes, but I'm saying everything we have it together.
Amen.
And I would not be here talking to you like this if I didn't have a good marriage. Now, did I say that we don't have talking at times? Yes. Marriage is punctuated. Good marriages are punctuated with some little hard times. Because any marriage that is not tested is not marriage at all.
Amen.
You see, when we got married young. But our firm decision was divorce was never an option.
Amen.
So regardless of what happened to us, we knew that we had to come back to each other. Now, I move on. We are going to finish now. Now, always settle your problems immediately. Somebody must be always willing to accept wrong. Now, when one person is always wrong, there's going to be a problem in the marriage.
Yes.
Now, I met them. When I was canvassing, I met Delois. She's from Nevis. And we got into talking, and Delois said to me, said, Daniel, you know why Edric and I get along so well? It's because we never sleep on a problem. Any problem we had, we settled it before we went to bed. Any problem that you leave overnight swells. It seems bigger. Always settle it immediately. And I don't understand. Now, if both of you are Christians, both are Christians, now, you are going to pray to God. In other words, your prayers meet around the common mercy seat. Now, if Christ is in you, and Christ is in you, well, Christ and Christ can't fight.
True.
While there may be a slight disagreement, Christ and Christ will come together. Settle it. Hey, you all hear what I say?
Yes.
All right. Avoid the influence from parents and friends, in-laws. I say avoid. Now, there are too many marriages break up because some in-law, maybe a mother-in-law or some in-law, is too nosy.
True.
And gets into the people's business.
True.
Y'all don't hear me. You know, when you're married, young man, is your wife comes first.
Amen.
And anytime your mother is saying that she's first, put her in a place. Is the mother, the wife is first.
All the time.
Now, respect your mother. Respect your parents, but the wife is first. Now, there is someone who, I don't know if it's Power who made up the song. When he said, if my mother and my wife were drowning, whom would I save? And the Calypsonian said, I will save my mother, because when I can get another wife, I cannot get another mother. But now, I don't look at it that way. If my mother and my wife were drowning, and my father were there, he would save his wife. No, serious. He would save his wife. Well, I am not going to save his wife for him. No, I'm saving my wife.
Amen.
Serious. My wife. Oh, yes. He got to save his wife for himself. And I'm coming to the close, huh? Now, never cheat. I said, never cheat on your spouse. You see, you got to develop trust. What cheating does, it breaks the trust. Mm-hmm. And once that trust is broken, it is hardly ever repaired. Be faithful to one another.
Amen.
I say, be faithful to each other. Now, some men feel that their wives can't supply them. It's because of the way you treat the wife. See, an old man told me one time that a wife that is well-treated can handle any man. Well, you come next week, Wednesday night, thank God for sex. I'll tell you all about that. You see, young men, I'll tell you something. Hear me about women loves. As if I don't know anything about Concord. Hey, my friend. Concord, agreement of subject and predicate. Eh? Yeah, women love plenty shoes.
True.
And bags matching and matching hat.
Yes.
Well, listen now, man. Hey, why buy plenty shoes for your wife? Come on, yeah. And matching bag. And everything, listen, folks. No, I'm telling you the plain truth. We are married for 43 years, and my wife has hardly ever bought anything for any dress for herself. Man, is I buy them with the, by the dozens and everything there. Man, I treat her good. Real good. Why do you think she has to come here by me? Huh? This is what you call compensation time. What happens to you? No, but look. No, serious. Listen, folks, the lady needs nothing. Any catalog magazine that comes home is my name on it. She does not know when I order. All she knows, when she comes from school, they're on the bed.
You said on the bed?
Yeah, they're on the bed.
Amen.
Yeah. They're right there. No. I'm saying you got to treat the lady like a queen. You see, a lady loves to be treated that way. No, I don't care anything about flowers and all things, but I want to make sure that she's happy, and when she's happy, I am happy.
Amen, amen.
I'm happy. Trust me. She has to buy nothing. So all that allowance that she got there, all she does is waste it up. Because it's not to buy clothes, no nothing. It is just to give it away. And let me tell you something. The other day, the checkbook finished. And for almost a year, you know, my wife didn't have a checkbook, so the money kept piling up and piling up. I had to force this young and tell her, get a checkbook, because, you know, because it was costing me too much. When she, every little thing that, you know, she was leaving her thing there to pile up and pile up. But now she has checkbook.
Amen.
Yeah, when every time somebody wants something, and she comes to me, but I don't have to do it now, because she has a checkbook. No, we get along very well. I got to admit, we get along. Next point here is, when early in the marriage, we had our problems too. But as you grow older, what are you going to have problems for? Listen, look at this point here. You got to control your temper. Now, you know that the Bible says that a soft answer
turn it away, right?
Is not what you say, you know, it's how you say it. Now, a woman's mind is very delicate. So you rough up that lady, man, say it a little softer. Find another way of saying it. And she's not offended. Because when a woman is offended, she shut her mouth. And when she shuts her mouth, it can be a whole week before she opens it again. No. Hold on, am I talking truth? No, that's true. All right, now, we're coming to the end. Now, ladies and gentlemen, married couples got to learn to adjust. I say you got to learn to adjust. No two people are exactly alike. Now, look at it. You all come from two different families. Now, Brother Belfour, you are from the Belfour family. And your wife is from whatever family she came from. Now, the Belfour family got some bad habits. And your family got some bad habits. Come on. We'll call hereditary problems. Now, it is like this. I am a Daniels. My wife is a Brandy. Now, the Brandys got some bad ways. But I discovered that the Daniels have some worse ways. No, serious. We got some worse ways. So now, both of us got to learn to adjust.
Amen.
Come on,
amen.
Now, listen to me now. So that I can cope with the Brandy bad ways, and she can cope with my worst ways.
Amen.
Because I am asking her to cope with Daniel's ways. So why shouldn't I cope with the Brandy's ways? Now, I know certain problems that my wife has. I know. So, but it doesn't worry me anymore. Because I know that I have problems too.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
I got my problem too.
Yes, yes,
so
yes,
we have to
yes.
come together. This is the only yes. time I believe that we ought to compromise. Yes, because no two people are exactly alike. This, some people were born in Guyana with the Guyanese ways, and some born in Trinidad with the Trinidad ways.
Yes!
In closing, my friend, May Christ the foundation of your marriage. As the Bible says, whoever loveth not, knoweth not God, because God is love.
Yes.
So all love, the love comes from God. Trust me, even the erotic love. And Psalm 127 and verse 1, God says there, except the Lord build a house, yes. the labor in vain.
Build it.
Except Christ is in your marriage is vain. Let Christ be always the foundation of your marriage. And God bless you all until next week. Now, all of you, God, by God's help, want to hear, thank God for sex. Raise your hand. You don't want to hear it? Thank God for sex. That's what I say. Now, put up your hand. Put up your hand now. Don't pretend now. Put up your hand. So, sister, put up your hand. Next week, Wednesday night. Thank God for sex. Now, have you all been blessed with the council tonight?
Yes.
Do you think it's worthwhile? Okay, let us all stand. Let us stand and let me pray for you. And put the song on the screen already. Love at home. Bow your heads. Everybody now. Bow your heads. Just bow your heads wherever you are. Eternal and everlasting God and Father. It has been a wonderful night. So many people come from all over Trinidad to hear about love and courtship and marriage. Lord, many homes are rocking tonight. Some of them don't know where to turn. But let us turn to you.
Amen.
For we believe that you are the foundation of all good marriages. And bless these folks, Lord. And I pray that everyone here tonight will be back tomorrow night to hear, why don't you be like Doubting Thomas? So we commit them into your care in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Love at home. Take off the lights and let us sing it now. Song leaders, love at home. Hold on. No, wait now. Smoother. Let me hear play that. A little smoother. No, not joking.
There is beauty all around when it's all at home. No.
Now, don't leave us yet. Let us sing it now. Come on, let's sing it. Come on, let's sing now.
There is beauty all around when there's love at home.
Sing it out.
There is joy in every sound when there's love at home. Peace and plenty here arrive, smiling fair on every side.
Of the lateness of the hour, I will dismiss you, and as you go, we'll continue to sing. Hands across your hearts. I will follow thee, my Savior. Thou didst shed thy blood for me. And the all men should forsake thee.
By thy grace I'll follow thee.
And now may love, joy, and peace from God the Father, and God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost be with us now and forevermore. Amen. See you all tomorrow night. Continue singing, song leader. Continue singing as they go. Put on the lights. Sing it.